today. Just one thing, one scripture, one verse. It's only one sentence, one premise. It's real simple. One thing. But if you miss this thing, you will be deceived. Perhaps you might be deceiving yourself into thinking that this is something that you're doing. And sometimes we have to get back to the basics to make sure that we're not missing anything. So today we are just going to deal with one thing. Just one thing. Now, I want to read this scripture, but when we read it, because it's very familiar, I'm asking you not to just quote it off your memory. I'm asking you to look at God's word and read the scripture. Amen? You know, sometimes we get, you know, we know the scripture, we just start repeating it, and we repeat it with no fervor, no zeal. We don't even care. We're just saying it because we know what comes next.
Come on.
I want to read the scripture today, and I want you to allow the Holy Spirit to show you something that maybe you didn't see before in this passage of scripture.
All right.
Amen?
Amen.
All right, so if I can ask you guys to please stand in honor of his word. When we read scripture, it should always be read with fervor. That's why we end with, and this is the word of God. Because this is God's spoken word through the Holy Spirit by the pens of 40 men. So if you could turn your Bibles to the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verse 5. I'm glad I still hear pages turning. For the sake of you hearing that scripture and not just saying, oh, I know this. At this point, you do not know this. I want you to treat this like you've never seen this scripture before. Everyone there?
Yes.
Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. And it reads, trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. This is the word of God. You may be seated. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is a passage of scripture that has become extremely cliche across the Christian community. Extremely cliche. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. And you just start quoting it, and we just say it, and we apply it to everything with no real meaning, no real substance behind it, no real thought into it. God's word is not to be done in such a manner. So let's get right into it. The one verse. One verse. Here's your exegesis, because I always give exegesis when I preach. It's only one verse, so it won't be long. First off, we start with trust. Now, trust means to believe in the reliability, truth, ability, or strength of. To believe in the reliability, truth, ability, or strength of. Now, some synonyms would be to have faith in, or to put place one, or to place one's trust in, to have every confidence in, to believe in, to pin one's hope or faith on, to rely upon. You can bank on. You can count on. You can be sure of. Or be convinced by. That is trust. Trust. But the scripture says, trust in who?
The Lord.
Trust in the Lord. Trust in the Master. Trust in God. Trust in the Lord. You're not trusting, we're not asking you to trust in your spouse, your friend, your associates. Don't trust in the world. Trust God.
Yes. Yes.
And then the key is, with all your heart. Not a little piece. Not just the things that you want to, that just seem easy. Oh, I'll just trust that. God, you'll take care of that. You know, it's only 50 cents anyway. You'll take care of that, God. But I'm going to stress over the big bills.
Come on.
Trust God with all your heart. Not some, but all. And then the verse continues to, and lean not on your own understanding.
Yeah.
Lean not on your own understanding.
Mm-hmm.
So think what's being said here. Think about what's being said here. Like I said, I'm not going to be long, so I'm just gonna dive right in. We're going to get right into the points, and I'll take my seat. The first point is simply this. Trust is not an attack on your intelligence. It's an attack on your ego. I'm going to say that again. Trust is not an attack on your intelligence. It's an attack on your ego. When you have to trust God, you don't have to become stupid to do it. Many atheists are out there saying, well, faith is, the whole concept of faith makes no sense. It's all fake anyway. They say, well, in order to have faith or any of that stuff, you have to just remove all intellect from yourself. No. That's not what it is. When we're talking about faith and trust, what we're talking about is recognizing that you only have one perspective, and that is yours. That you're not smart enough to know it all. So again, it's not an attack on your intelligence. It's an attack on your ego. A lot of us, myself included at times, my wife will tell you, think that they're right all the time. Wife, keep your head still. I see you moving over there. Amen. So what the scripture says, your understanding, it's talking about what you know based on your perspective. And we have to remember that God knows all. God doesn't have a perspective. He has it. He doesn't have a perspective of anything that's happening. He has it. He sees all of it and everything else that's happening all at the same time. So while we only see from our direction that little bit, that little tidbit that we do see, he sees all of it. He also knows the future, which we don't know. God doesn't want us to bird box our situations. He doesn't want us to just walk around blindfolded, for those of you that don't know what bird box is. That's not what God is looking for us to do. He's looking for us to trust him.
Amen.
He wants us to understand that there are things that we cannot see.
Amen.
So we can't go around getting all big and puffed up and carried away thinking that we have this infinite knowledge when only God possesses that. So we have to put aside the great knowledge that we think we have and acknowledge that God sees, knows, and directs more than we could even think of. That's trusting in God. Knowing that God sees way more than you see. In order to trust God with your whole heart, you must place your ego somewhere else. You must remove your ego. So that first point simply was, trust is not an attack on your intellect, it's an attack on your ego.
Amen.
The second one, trust requires patience.
All right.
And I know we don't like to say that, we don't like to hear that, but trust requires patience.
Amen.
I will say it again, trust requires patience.
Amen.
I'm not saying it for the amens. I'm saying it for myself. Trust requires patience. There are times we ask for things and we want it yesterday. But God knows that if He gives you it today, it will not make it to tomorrow. We have to remember that God's time is not our time. Sometimes God wants us to just sit down somewhere and stop trying to fix the problem. Sometimes we have to take a seat and let God work. God can be working on things behind the scenes for you and trying to, and you keep jumping in trying to do it yourself. You keep untying everything He ties up. And you wonder why the process keeps taking so long for you to see the other side of the drama that you're caught in. Because you keep trying to do it yourself. You are leaning on your own understanding. Sometimes we have to get out of the way and get silent. For most of us, what we want it right now. There's going to be some times where your closest friends are going to come to you and ask you questions. What are you doing? And you have to just simply say, I'm trusting God.
Okay.
Yes.
Because God told you to trust Him.
That's what He said. Yes.
And if God told you to sit there and be quiet, sit there and be quiet.
Come on.
You all know what an antsy child, and what they call with ADHD now today, and they got a whole bunch of sugar and they're just super excited, they can't be still. That's us. That's how God sees us sometimes. We sit there swinging our legs on the chair. God, come on, come on. God, do something. Come on. And all God wants us to do is just sit there and be still. Third point. I told you I only got three. We're getting out of here quick. Trust requires action. Now, when we get to the next part, I'll try to sew that up. But trust requires action. Sometimes God has some things set up for you. All you have to do is just walk into it. God may have a promise for you waiting around the corner, but you have to get up and get it. I'm reminded of the story, and I think I've heard it in this church several times, of the woman who wanted to get a car. She wanted to get a car, but she couldn't afford it. But she was asking God to bless her with a vehicle. And one day she just decided she was going to clean out her garage. And someone asked her, what are you doing? She said, I'm making a place. I'm preparing a place for God's blessing in my life. We have to clean out that space for God's blessing to come in. How about another simple story, one that you've all heard before, right? There's this guy, this old man, his name was Noah. And God had looked all over the earth for someone that was righteous, and He couldn't find anyone but Noah and his family. God gives him instructions to build an ark, and it takes Noah a little less than 100 years to build this ark. Now that's trust. And that's some action and that's some patience.
Yes.
Because here you are building this ark for almost 90 years. You have to imagine folks is walking by like, what are you doing? And there is no indication in the Bible that Noah lived on the coastline. I mean, I'm just saying. I'm not going to say he lived in the heartland, but I'm just going to say there's no indication that he lived in a port. And this is where this ark was being built. Can you imagine driving to Riverside and just seeing somebody building a boat in Riverside? While you're driving through, there's a big old boat being built on the side of the road.
Wow.
And remember, they didn't have technology at the time. So this is not like, you know, he's building it on a trailer. No, he's just building this huge boat, the ark. Basically, 10% of Noah's life was spent preparing for a flood that was going to come in God's timing.
Yes.
God didn't tell Noah when the flood was coming. God told Noah to build the ark. Now, the average American lives 78 years. Let's do some simple math here. I'm going to round that to 80. And imagine spending 10% of your life, that's 8 years of your life, building and preparing for something that God has for you. But he hasn't shown you what it is that's coming yet. And he says, it's coming. Build. Imagine spending 10 years, 8 years, however many years of your life preparing for something. Now, by the silence, I'm going to take it that most of you guys are trying to think of something that God has been preparing you for. All right. I want you to know that God has told all of you guys to prepare for something. Now, whether you heard him or not is a different story. Whether you're actually preparing what he told you to prepare is a different story. But God has told each and every one of us to do something. To prepare for something. So Noah had to just trust God. God told him something and he had to see it through. Now, that's not to say that there weren't moments of doubt during that process of building. Noah could have gone back to God and said, hey, God, you know, everyone just keeps laughing at me. They keep ridiculing me. You know, my kids are getting talked about. My family's being talked about because I'm building this boat way out here, Lord. I mean, we have to just imagine this conversation, right? But you're talking to God.
Yes.
And if God says it's coming.
It's coming.
So I know what you might be thinking, though. You might be thinking, well, you just told us that trust requires patience.
Mm-hmm.
And then you turned around and told us that trust requires action. Well, which is it? Or how do I know? How do I determine when to be still and when to get busy? I'm glad you asked. So we're now in the life application portion of this sermon. It's real simple. In order for you to know what God wants you to do in the moment of trusting him, you have to use one thing. The word is called discernment. The word is called discernment. What it means is that you know and are able to distinguish the difference between God's voice and all the other chatter that you hear. Trust me. There's a couple voices, probably just one voice in my head, right? But there's a couple voices probably on my shoulders trying to tell me, hey, do this, do this, do that, do this. One of the biggest questions that I get from a lot of the teens is, how do I know when God is talking to me? And the interesting thing is I don't know how many adults actually know that answer. How do you know when God is talking to you? My answer is always simple. It's always simple. That communication with God is just like communication with someone else. The more you talk to them, the more you learn their voice.
Come on. Come on.
So the more you communicate with God, the more you will learn his voice.
Yeah.
And one thing you will always know is that God will never tell you to do something that is against his word. So you can always bounce whatever you heard up against God's word.
Yeah.
Now, there's two requirements here. Number one, you have to be able to hear and distinguish that it's God's voice.
Yeah.
Number two, you also have to be able to know God's word in order to bounce whatever you heard up against it. So what we thought was something real simple and basic in trust becomes a little bit deeper. It becomes a little bit deeper because you have to actually know what you're trusting.
Yes.
You have to know who you're trusting. It requires relationship.
Yes.
This is the difference between Christianity and religion.
All right.
It requires relationship.
Yes.
Can you imagine being a Jew and not having a direct relationship with God? Having to go through somebody else? When your repentance comes through an animal? Could you imagine that today? Here we are, 2019, and still we don't have the relationship that we should have with our God, with our Creator. We take for granted the relationship.
Yes, help us.
And I'm not talking about when you wake up, you pray.
Come on, man.
And when you go to bed, you pray. And you say your grace over your food. Unless you do all of that with fervor.
Right.
If you do all of that with fervor, by all means. But most of us, if we're being honest, Lord, thank you for this food I'm about to receive for the nourishment of my body. In Jesus Christ's name, I pray. Amen. And it's a quick rush because I already smell it while I'm praying. Lord, those green beans just hit me hard. I gotta end this. But the truth is, we're rushing to the blessings of God and passing right over who gave us the blessing.
Yeah.
When was the last time you truly thanked him for the food? Like truly thanked him. Like unveiled a prayer that you've never said before for grace. You know, we get real comfortable in grace. We got formats and all that kind of stuff. You teach the kids and, you know, all of that. When was the last time Lord, you didn't have to give me this food.
That's right.
You blessed me with something I was not... I don't even deserve this, Lord God, but you blessed me with this meal. You blessed me with the money. You blessed me with the job. You blessed me with an opportunity to get this food. Lord, I thank you for this meal. So we have to use discernment. The more you communicate with God, the more you will know it's him when he's speaking to you. And once you get that great line of communication going, it becomes easier for you to hear his voice. He'll direct you to do some things that may not make sense now. But when he reveals it all to you, it'll be life changing. You have to be able to trust God enough not to abort the mission. You've got to be able to trust God to do what he said he was going to do. You've got to be able to trust God in your relationships. You've got to be able to trust God in your prayer life. Don't just be throwing some words up to him.
Right.
Actually believe and trust that he's going to do what you're asking for.
Amen.
You've got to be able to trust God in your fellowship.
Yes.
You've got to be able to trust God in your household.
Yes.
You've got to be able to trust God in your work or your business. Many of us in this very room right now have businesses that God wants to birth through us. But because we won't get out the boat, Peter, because we won't get out the boat,
come on.
Just like Peter did. If Peter got out the boat and said, Lord, if it's you, call me unto you.
Right.
If we could just step out the boat. Many of us have been outside the wall for so long. You thought your destination was way over there, but your destination is right in front of your face. God is just saying, just take a step. Just trust me. Just go to the other side. Just walk around that corner. Go see this man. Go do this. It's the simple things. God is trying to get us to move towards him. We got to be like Peter and take that step out the boat towards Jesus. We have to be able to trust God in our academic endeavors. We have to trust God in ministry. We have to trust God in this world. As sin surrounds us in this crazy place that we call America, we have to trust God. We have to trust Him in the good times. We have to trust Him in the bad times. When it seems like there's nothing else wrong that can happen to you, you still have to trust Him. You got to be like Job when he said, though He slay me, yet will I trust Him. I'm going to trust Him. You have to be able to trust God enough to know that He's never going to leave you nor forsake you. God's not going to take you to a place and drop you off there. God is with us. He will stay with us. He will never leave us. We must trust God over our own instincts, over what your mama and them said, over your cousins, over your friends. You have to trust God for yourself. God's vantage point is vast, where ours is narrow and all just our own perspective. We have to trust Him with all of our heart and lean not on our own understanding. Let us pray. Holy Father, I just pray right now, Lord God, that You will continue to blow on Your word.
Yes.
Father, while a seed may be planted, Lord, they need Your watering in order to germinate in our lives, Lord God. I pray, Father God, that I have done You righteously today, Lord God. I pray that in sharing Your word, Father, that someone would receive Your word, Lord God, and trust You. Lord, I pray that the glory is Yours, Father God, that all that we did and all that we do, Lord God, would be for Your glory. For we know, Lord God, that if we don't trust You, we don't have anything, Lord God. So, God, I pray that You will bless these Your people, Lord God, those under the sound of my voice, that You would bless them and help them to trust You, Lord God. Help them to get back to the basics, Lord God, so that we can understand the things of depth, Lord God. If we can just gather the things on the surface first, Lord God, I pray that You will just bless us with understanding and clarity in Your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.